Hey everyone, it's Lynette, and this is my Illuminae and Gemina book review. About the first book, Illuminae, and you can see my dust jacket is no longer existent because I lost it. I'm horrible with dust jackets, but I love the cover of this book so much. Even without the dust jacket, it's still a really cool, you can see it's like, it looks like a FBI document that's like been, you know, X'd out and blacked out, and there's writing and things like that, but the dust jacket is this beautiful burnt orange, and it's sort of translucent, so you can see a little bit of the writing through it. It's just such an aesthetically pleasing book to pick up, which is why it initially drew me to it. My sister and I were walking through the bookstore, and we were just checking out the new Best in Teen table when this first came out. I don't know how long ago that was now, several months back. And we saw this book, and initially, you know, the cover drew me to it, and I picked it up and knew nothing about the book whatsoever and started leafing through it, and we just decided we were going to take a chance on this book, and we both bought it, we both took it home and loved it so, so much. It's now one of my all-time favorite series, and I'm so happy that we took a chance on this book and bought it the day we saw it, knowing nothing about it, knowing nothing about the story or the content or the setup or the format or anything. We took a chance on Illuminae, and it's now so, so dear to my heart. I love this book so much. So with that being said, of course I gave this book a 5 out of 5 stars. I thought it was brilliant. I thought it was just geniusly done. It was beautifully put together. As you probably already know, the style is called mixed media, which means it's told through a series of text messages and sort of pictures and all different kinds of things. We have this, this page is a countdown, so you know it's counting down to something epic. I mean, some of these pages are just insanely pretty. I didn't know if the format was going to be for me at first, but I found that I really, really enjoyed it. I had reservations about it because I didn't know if I could, you know, really get into the story or care about the characters when I'm not really seeing them directly. You're just learning about the characters through their instant messages and diary entries and things like that, security cam footage and things like that. But you really, really get to know the characters, and you really start to care about what happens to them and their well-being, and you start to feel for their plight. So this book, just a quick synopsis, takes place into the future. I think it's like 2575 was the year. It takes place solely in outer space on this planet called Credenza. Katie is our main character, and her boyfriend Ezra had just broken up the day before. And the day after they break up, this big mega corporation decides that they're going to blow up their planet. So they have to flee on these starships. And when they get on the starships, you know, everybody's sort of trying to look for their families. Katie is looking for her mother, who is stationed on another starship. But you have, you know, these layouts of these ships and blueprints of these ships, and it's so beautifully done. But anyway, there's so much stuff happens. You have this rogue AI system that runs the starships. You have this plague that breaks out in the brig on the starship and starts to infect people aboard the ship. And then you have the drama and the romance sort of between Katie and Ezra, and them trying to mend their relationship in the midst of their world completely ending, and them trying to get to this jump station where they think that they will be able to find peace and resolution and at least a little bit of safety. So the premise of it is just, it's so interesting. The science of this book, you know, even though it's fiction, even though it's made up, the science sounds so real and so, it's just so smartly, geniusly done. So I already talked a little bit about the characters, Katie and Ezra. I thought they were both very relatable, very well done, very complex characters. Like I said, I was nervous that we wouldn't get to know them because of the mixed media format, but that quickly proved me wrong. You definitely got inside Katie's head, even though it's in a mixed media format. You definitely knew what she was thinking, and you definitely started to care about whether or not she lived or died. You know, you sort of started rooting for these characters in the end. So I was very, very happy to know that even though it was in a different format that I was not used to, you still got a sense of who these people were and what their plight was, and you really did start to care about them. As for the plot of this book, there is not one moment of this book that is slow or that drags. The plot is very much action-packed. The story is plot-driven. It goes from one action scene to the next with barely giving the reader a chance to catch their breath, but I like fast-paced books like that. The first page, it jumps you right into the planet exploding. It jumps you right into the action, and you don't get any background about these characters. You just jump right into the story, and I just thought that was so neat. I loved that it just got right to the point. It told you the story it wanted to tell, and it didn't give you any filler pages or anything like that. Everything you needed to know about the story was included in the book, and you didn't get any filler. You didn't get any fluffy pages full of stuff that you don't care about. Everything was relevant to the story. Everything just flowed together so wonderfully. Because it is in this mixed media kind of format, I felt it went very quick. You know, it is a plot-driven book. It is a lengthy book. It's 608 pages, but I swear to you, I sat down and knocked this book out in an evening. I could not stop reading this once I got started. So don't let the 608 pages throw you for a loop or scare you away from this book, because it can be done in one sitting. I did it in one evening, and I have two kids. So it can be done. Don't let that be daunting. Some of the pages are really just kind of pictures, so you can just kind of flip through them or skim them. You know, they're like, this page is just all one word, just, you know, but it forms a picture. So a lot of the pages are like that. It's all relevant to the story. It all makes sense once you read it, but a lot of the pages don't have a ton of words on it, so it does make the flow of the story go much faster than a normal 608 page book. I don't want to say too much else about the plot because I don't want to give any of the juicy details of this book away. I don't want to spoil anything for you if you haven't read this, but the plot had so many twists and turns, so many ups and downs. There was so many times I was on the edge of my seat. There were so many times where I gasped out loud while reading this. I mean, it was just, it made my head spin of how many plot twists and turns there were in this story. It was beautiful. As for the second book, Gemina, it does follow the same mixed media kind of format, through text messages, security cam footage, hacked documents, and things like that. So again, it is a lengthy book, but it goes very, very fast, especially with some of the pages not having very many words on it. Gemina follows a different set of characters, Hannah and Nick, which are very similar to Katie and Ezra, and normally I wouldn't like that, but it totally works for the book. I didn't care that they were so similar to the first set of characters. It made it feel like the same story. Normally I don't like it when a book uses a different set of characters in the sequel, but it totally worked on this. It's not like they don't talk about Katie and Ezra at all, because they do. Katie is present in the end of the book as well, so you know that when Obsidio comes out in March, it's going to be about all four of them, and I hope it just really wraps up loose ends nicely with both stories that are happening. But like I said, where Gemina takes place on the starship that is escaping from the exploded planet, Gemina takes place on the jump station of where Katie and Ezra's starship is trying to get to. It's showing you what's happening and all the drama happening on the jump station at the same time all this other stuff is happening on Katie's starship. This delves deeper into the story. It delves deeper into, you know, why Katie's planet was exploded. It delves deeper into the mega corporation that's behind it all. So you know that the exploding of Katie's planet was just the beginning of all of this madness and all of this drama. It's only the tip of the iceberg because the story is just so much deeper and more complex. I have no doubt that when Obsidio comes out, it's going to go even further and resolve a whole bunch of questions we have. As with Illuminae, I don't want to say too much about the plot of Gemina, especially if you haven't read Illuminae. I don't want to spoil anything for you, but again, there's a lot of stuff that's going on this jump station. It's not the peaceful escape that Katie and Ezra were hoping it would be. There's a lot of stuff going on with it too, and the big corporation is behind it all as well. If you have not read Illuminae and Gemina, please, please don't hesitate to read them. Just because they're different, it has nothing to do with the story. The story is still there, it's still compelling, the characters are still complex, and you still care about them. Third book, Obsidio, comes out in March, March 6th, I believe, so mark that on your calendars, and make sure that you pick up both of these books before then so that you can be all ready for the release of Obsidio. That's all for this video, and thank you so much for watching. Be sure to like and subscribe on this video, and I will see you next time. Bye, guys.